I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me.
We welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to another Bible study presented by the New Covenant Apostolic Church. And my name is Brother Tim Early, and I'll be leading this Bible study today in the Apostolic Doctrine of Water Baptism. And this is part two. What do the Scriptures say about baptism? The purpose of these studies is to answer the questions, must I be baptized in order to be saved? And what is the purpose of baptism in the New Covenant? The blood of Jesus was shed for the remission of sins according to Matthew 26 and 28. And that shedding of blood took place when Jesus died upon the cross. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which was shed for many for the remission of sins. Colossians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Just like in the old covenant sacrificial system, when a burnt offering was made by the priest for an individual's sin, the recipient of the sin offering had to be directly identified with the death of the sacrifice. The individual bringing the sin offering was required to lay their hand upon the head of the offering, transferring their own sin guilt onto the substitute. And through the death of that substitutionary sin offering, the blood of that sacrifice was applied by faith to the recipient for the atonement of their sin. According to Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, and the Lord called unto Moses, and spake unto him out of the tabernacle of the congregation, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, if any man of you bring an offering unto the Lord, ye shall bring your offering of the cattle, even of the herd, and of the flock. If his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. And he shall put his hand upon the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. And he shall kill the bullock before the Lord. And the priests, Aaron's sons, shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood round about the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. According to Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 4 and 20, the penalty of sin is death. And knowing that the heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, God gave the substitutionary offerings of animals to make atonement for the people of the old covenant, that they died not. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. And so it is in the New Testament by Jesus Christ, our substitute, our propitiation. In Romans 3 and 25, we read this, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. Propitiation is the act of appeasing anger or wrath, to gain favor instead of punishment. We too must be personally identified with the death of Jesus Christ, our substitute, that the precious blood of his offering would be applied by faith to us for the atonement of our sins. This is not a symbolic gesture. This is a spiritual reality. And we read in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 12 through 14, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and of the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? How do we receive the blood of Jesus Christ for the remission of our sins? And when is the blood applied to us? Is it by simply believing that Jesus died for us? Jesus has said that his blood was shed for many for the remission of sins, according to Matthew 26 and 28, which we read. And the blood gives remission of sins, according to that scripture. And the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 2 and verses 38 to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Now, reasoning these two scriptures together, that his blood was shed for the remission of sins and baptism is for the remission of sins, we can conclude that the blood of Jesus is applied to the believer through water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. If this statement is true, then the scriptures will confirm it. And if this statement is not true, the scriptures will also confirm it. We briefly spoke about the sin offerings under the Old Covenant and how one who was making the sin offering was to be identified with the death of the offering being given. First by laying their hand upon the head of the offering and then by killing the offering themselves. When are we identified with the death of Jesus Christ, our substitutionary offering? What does the Bible say? According to Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 4, we are baptized into his death. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. And Colossians chapter 2 and verse 12 also says that we are buried with him in baptism. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. Our old sinful life is buried in that watery grave through the authority of the name of Jesus Christ. And we are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, to walk with him in newness of life and to serve him in newness of spirit. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5 says, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Let's bring attention to the word washed used in Revelation 1 and 5. In the last study, we gave the definition of the word baptize, translated from the Greek word baptizo. And one of the meanings was to wash, to cleanse by dipping. Revelation 1 and 5 says that unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. And Ananias told Paul in Acts 22 and 16, and now why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Clearly we can see the connection with the washing away of sins and baptism from Acts chapter 22 and 16. And we can then also reason that the way Jesus washed us from our sins in his own blood, as we read in Revelation 1 and 5, is through baptism. Why can we confidently say that? It's because Scripture tells us in Acts 2 and 38 that baptism is for the remission of sins, and remission is the removal. Paul told the Corinthian saints that they had been washed, sanctified, and justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, according to 1 Corinthians 6:11. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Can anyone really say that the washing that is being described in the Scriptures is the washing of taking a bath? We know that the Scriptures are referring to the washing or cleansing of sin. So let's recap. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed for the remission of sins, according to Matthew 26, 28. And baptism in the name of Jesus Christ is for the remission of sins, Acts 2 and 38. In Acts chapter 10 and verse 43, we read this, to him give all the prophets witness, that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. This verse states that through the name of Jesus Christ, whosoever believes in him shall receive remission of sins. Some would say that this verse says you only have to believe in him to receive the remission of sins. Like we mentioned in part one of this study, those that believed obeyed the preaching of John and were baptized confessing their sin. You must believe in Jesus and be baptized in his name for the remission of sin. There are many scriptures that support this fact. And we read in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And in Luke chapter 24 and verse 47, we also read this, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Now we can start to see why the apostles baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. The blood of Jesus is in the name of Jesus, and it is by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ that our sins are remitted. It was in baptism that the apostles instructed us to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to wash away our sins, as we read in Acts chapter 22 and verse 16. And Acts chapter 2 and verse 21 tells us this, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And Romans 10 and 13 says this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. These scriptures are not telling us to simply call upon the name of Jesus and you will be saved. But just as Ananias told Paul to be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. These verses are referring to calling on the name of the Lord Jesus in baptism for the remission of sins. The salvation that Jesus died for was the salvation over the sin that has held us in bondage. 1 Peter chapter 2 and 24, it speaks of the healing of sin. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. The being dead to sin spoken of in 1 Peter 2 and 24, we can ask the question, when did we die to sin? Romans 6 and 4 says that we are buried with him by baptism into death. We said before, if you have not been planted together in the likeness of his death, then you will not share in the likeness of his resurrection. It is by baptism that we are planted together in the likeness of his death. Romans 6 and 5. Why would the Bible say so much about baptism and make so many different references to baptism if baptism is not necessary for salvation? Beginning at Jerusalem, Peter said this in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Acts 2 and 38 tells us the who, how, and why of baptism. The who is every one of you. The how is in the name of Jesus Christ, and the why is for the remission of sins. You must be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. It is in the waters of baptism that the blood of Jesus is applied to the believer by faith. And if you have not been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, then there has been no remission. You are still in your sins. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, we read this, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. There are many believers that quote this scripture to justify their belief that baptism is not necessary for salvation. They say that if you confess with your mouth and believe on Jesus in your heart, you will be saved. Ask the question again, saved from what? These verses say nothing about the remission of sins. They speak of confession and belief. You can confess all you want, and you can believe that Jesus rose from the dead all that you want, but that will not remove your sins according to Acts 2 and 38. In order for one to obey the command to repent and to be baptized, they must first believe on the Lord Jesus Christ with their whole heart, and repentance involves confession. What did Philip tell the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. After Philip explained the scriptures in the book of Isaiah, speaking of the death of Jesus, he continued to preach Jesus. And the first thing the eunuch wanted to do was to be baptized. How did the eunuch even know about baptism? The Bible says that Philip preached unto him Jesus. And that preaching must have included water baptism in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. The only condition given by Philip to the eunuch was belief, according to Acts chapter 8 and verse 37. If thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. Romans chapter 10 verses 9 and 10 are in perfect harmony with Acts chapter 2 and 38, because obedience requires belief and repentance requires confession. Matthew chapter 3 and verse 6, and they were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. What about all the scriptures that describe the apostles baptizing believers in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin? Do we ignore all of them? Are they no longer applicable to us? We cannot pick and choose which parts of the gospel we're going to believe. By doing so, we make the word of God of no effect, and we actually diminish from the Word of God. And Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 2 says this, ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall ye diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. Without receiving the remission of our sins through water baptism, the death of Jesus Christ is in vain, and our faith is in vain. His blood was shed for many for the remission of sins, and baptism is the method of receiving the remission of sins. It is plainly laid out in the scriptures, and yet there are millions of people believing you do not have to be baptized to be saved. That means there are millions of people who sincerely think that they have obeyed the gospel, but have not received the remission of their sins through baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. And because God hasn't shown up with a couple of angels to discuss his expectations, they think everything is all right. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, we read, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And John chapter 15 and verse 14, Jesus said this, ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Now let's look at the parable of the rich man and the beggar in Luke chapter 16. Now after it was too late for the rich man, he pleaded to send Lazarus back to warn his brethren of their coming fate. And to this, Abraham replied that they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. The reference to Moses and the prophets represent the law and the prophets. In other words, if they wouldn't hear the word of God, then there was no hope for them. We are no different today. If we neglect to read and study the Bible, and then we refuse to obey the instructions of salvation, then there is no hope for us outside of these scriptures. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. So here's a quote from an article that states that baptism is not necessary for salvation, and I quote, Baptism is the symbol of what has already occurred in the heart and life of one who has trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is an important step of obedience that every Christian should take as an act of testimony to others and a public declaration of the reality of our personal identification with Christ. How can baptism be a symbol for something that only comes by baptism? How can you say that you are in Christ before you are baptized into Christ, according to Galatians chapter 3 and 27? For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Acts 2 and 38 says to be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. It doesn't say be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for a symbol of the remission of sins. And here's another quote from the same article, that saying that we need to be baptized in order to be saved is dangerous, because it is saying there is something we must do to complete our salvation. The point this individual is trying to make is that salvation comes by grace through faith alone, and there is nothing that anyone can do to add to it. Saved by grace and not of works, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We agree that salvation comes by grace, grace being the unmerited favor of God that allows us to respond to the gospel through faith, the faith which cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And there is nothing that we can do to add to our salvation, but you must do something to receive it. You must obey. And an example of that is Acts chapter 16, verses 29 through 33. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And they spake unto him the words of the Lord and unto all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. Just like when John the Baptist preached the baptism of repentance, those that believed obeyed, and it was accounted unto them for righteousness, because they justified the word of God by being baptized. So it is for us in the New Testament. The problem is that people today are hearing a counterfeit gospel, a different message that Jesus and the apostles did not preach in the first century. You can't believe what you haven't heard, and you won't do what you do not know to do. Why would we not do what the apostles commanded the first century church to do in order to be saved? James chapter 2, verses 21 through 24 has this to say about works. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. If you're not willing to do what they did in the first century, then you won't have what they had. John said that they truly had fellowship with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ, according to 1 John 1 and 3. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And like those that were gathered at Jerusalem in Acts chapter 2, they witnessed the pouring out of the Holy Ghost upon the believers gathered in Jerusalem. And they heard them speaking in tongues in their own languages. And they heard the words of Peter, as recorded in Acts chapter 2, verses 14 through 40. And they heard the testimony of Jesus Christ expounded from the scriptures. And they heard about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They also heard the charges against their own selves concerning the Lord's death, and they believed every word. The Bible says that when they heard, they were pricked in their heart and asked, "What shall we do?" Now, if salvation comes by simply believing, as some say, Then the moment those men believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ and received the gospel message into their hearts, they should have been saved just by simply believing, right? Now again, if salvation comes by simply believing, this is where Peter should have said, you can't do anything to get saved, only believe. Sometime soon you should be baptized so that other people will know about the change that has already taken place in your hearts. But that is not what is recorded in the scriptures. They that believe were instructed by the apostles to do something. And if you truly believe and you truly see your own need for salvation, you will do whatever it is that the Word of God requires of you to be saved. And Acts 2:38 is a description of the application of what Jesus said in John chapter 3 and verse 5. Jesus said, a man must be born of water and of the Spirit, or he cannot see nor enter into the kingdom of God. There are too many scriptures pointing to the necessity of water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins to try and to ignore them all. According to the analogy of faith, it is always proper to assume that no contradictions or dual realities can exist in the Word of God. Either water baptism is necessary for salvation, or water baptism is not necessary for salvation. Someone is wrong. How can you say in one breath that water baptism is not essential for salvation? Then in the next breath say that everyone should be water baptized as an act of obedience because the Lord commanded it. Scripture cannot contradict Scripture. If Luke 24 and 47 says, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in His name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and Acts 2:38, it's written, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And then in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 says, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart and thou shalt be saved. It cannot mean that there is more than one way to receive salvation. One way by simply believing and confessing, and another way by believing and being baptized. But they must be taken together as parts of the whole message, that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in His name. And to those that believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins. Acts 10 and 48. And He commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. An Old Testament picture of baptism can be found in the story of Naaman the Syrian. In 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 through 14, Naaman was a captain of the host of the king of Syria, a great man and honorable, but he was a leper. And being told by an Israelite servant that there was a prophet in Samaria that could heal him, Naaman went to meet the prophet Elisha and came with his horses and with his chariot and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him saying, go, wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. But Naaman was wroth, and went away and said, behold, I thought he will surely come out to me, and stand, and call on the name of the Lord his God, and strike his hand over the place, and recover the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, rivers of Damascus, better than all the rivers of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. And his servants came near and spake unto him and said, my father, if the prophet had bid thee to do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather then when he saith to thee, wash and be clean? Then he went down and dipped himself 7 times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Did God need the water to make Naaman clean of his leprosy? Would Naaman have received the cleansing of his flesh if he had not obeyed the word to go and wash in the Jordan? The answer to both these questions is no. God gave Naaman a command telling him how to receive cleansing. Naaman's cleansing was waiting for his obedience. There was nothing he could do to add to it. But Naaman had to humble himself and obey the word of God in order to receive it. Naaman had to go where God commanded him to go, and he had to wash the way God commanded him to wash. And through his obedience, Naaman received his promised cleansing. Jesus came to offer himself a sacrifice for our sins, that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name. Are we not as Naaman was, the leper, coming to Jesus, the prophet, to be cleansed of our sin, represented by the leprosy? And the Lord sent out to us a messenger, the apostles, who told us to go and to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. We may doubt and we may resist and we may think it's not necessary or it should be done some other way, but it is God that has ordained that by faith in the name of Jesus Christ, through the act of water baptism, that he will wash away our sins with his own blood. The cleansing is already there, waiting in the name of Jesus. The work has already been finished by our Savior. Jesus has already shed his blood for the remission of sins and was raised again for our justification. And like Naaman's example, those that will humble themselves and obey the word of God shall receive the promised cleansing of sin. We pray that this study has been edifying to those that have already obeyed the word of God. And may this also serve to provoke others to go back to the scriptures again and re-examine themselves and the scriptures that we have discussed in this study concerning water baptism. Your salvation depends on it. If you have any questions or comments, please email us at thenewcovenantapostolicchurch@gmail.com. Thank you.
I've been crucified with Christ. I've been crucified with Christ. I know.